I had not been familiar with the house at all. And so when I started researching it and getting involved and discovering this, I'm from Texas. Like, it is a big thing in Northern California. And for those in, I guess, probably more familiar in the supernatural, people are more interested in the supernatural community, but I'd never heard of it before. And then to realize how important it was to so many people and how many people had memories of this place from their childhood. And you had mentioned the Winchester House to, and you just see people perk up and go, I've been there. It was really encouraging and really exciting to get involved in it. You know, to be honest, you have to take liberties with it because so much of it is a mystery. And which is what makes the house so fascinating, is because there are so many questions with the house. There are so many questions with its history. There are so many questions. I mean, it's called the Winchester Mystery House. It is an appropriate name for that place because when you walk through it, you don't get a lot of answers. You just get questions. You just get tons of questions of why is that there and why is that there? Why did she do this? Why was she doing this? So there are no definitive answers. I was expecting a fairly traditional, spacious mansion. And when you get actually into the house, it's incredibly claustrophobic. The walls are close in. There are room after room after room, but a lot of the rooms are very tiny. You don't know what's around the corner. It's very maze-like. So what struck me for the most part was how uncomfortable the place is from that energy. You know, like because it's so maze-like, it's so confined. When you have the longest eye line is when it's down a massive, massive, endless hall. But when you're not in those massive halls, it's one quick corner, another quick corner, into a maze, and then you hit the stairs and it goes into a wall. It's very confining. It does not feel like there's any rhyme or reason to it. I would call her formidable. She was a woman well ahead of her time. She was an inventor in her own right. She did not care about society's norms, and she had the money to do what she pleased. And after her husband died and she moved out west, there were constantly, you know, rumors and mumblings around the community of what was going on in this house. And this woman did not care. She had her belief in herself and belief in what she was doing. And she forged her own path. The Spierigs have always done their own stuff. So to the best of my knowledge, this is the first time they took a script and directed someone else's script. And so then they did a lot of rewrites of their own and really kind of made it their own. This is very much a Spierig piece, you know, like I feel like I handed an assist to them to a Spierig Brothers film, you know, like I initiated it, handed it off to them, and then they made it their own. So it was definitely two phases. It was my phase, the initial phase, and then the Spierigs came on, and then it was their phase, and they brought it home.